morning, I'm joined by some of the top guns at GRT Lawyers. Ashley Hill, Head of Disputes and Litigation, is here, as well as Scott Standen, the Head of Corporate. Welcome, gentlemen. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you.
Thank you, Elisha. It's a pleasure to be here.
So, gents, we're going to talk about CEO changes today, and there's a couple of topics we'd like to dive in. But I'd like to first open up the floor to both of you to talk about the raft of CEO changes that have been happening recently. We've seen it across the board on many of our ASX small caps, particularly in the last couple of weeks. And we've seen CEOs and executives leave seemingly immediately for any number of reasons. When these contracts do come into place, there's a three-month break clause here. And for those that are not familiar with this concept, can you detail for us what the three-month break clause is and why it's important?
Sure, thanks, Elisha. I'm happy to start with that. So I think it's first of all important just to distinguish between some of the parties that have left. There's a distinction between executives of the company and perhaps non-executive directors of the company. So executives obviously are subject to employment agreements and have some degree of a term to their employment. Non-executive directors don't. They can leave, and they also can be removed by shareholders anytime. But in terms of executives, the 3 months, in fact, I think is probably at the bottom end for executives of a company. And oftentimes we would expect to see notice periods for longer than that. And principally the reason for that is to protect the interests of the company, in that if you're that senior, it can take time to replace somebody. They have a degree of knowledge of the operations of the company. It's important to ultimately transition that to somebody else, or to protect the interests of the company if the sort of key executives are looking to leave and move on elsewhere. So it's a very important thing that is in employment contracts. It's something that's quite often negotiated quite significantly between executive and company. But as you point out, often not necessarily fulfilled when someone leaves abruptly. So I'm sure Ash might have some comments about that.
Yeah, Alicia, what I'd say about that is it's often a cliched term you'll hear used by lawyers in particular, is that every case turns on its own facts. And so depending on the circumstances that arise in any given case, 3 months, as Scott said, I don't think is an overly long period of time. And in circumstances where you'd have significantly longer, as Scott also mentioned, there's real scope there, and it happens a lot. We see it a lot, where those periods are negotiated down, you know, to the mutual benefit of both parties. Either the executive wants to leave immediately for whatever reason, and the company's happy to see that happen.
There can certainly be a number of reasons why a CEO can leave in the early stages of his appointment. Tell me, if there is a problem, is it best for the CEO to leave immediately?
Well, I think, again, Ash's point, it'll depend largely on the circumstances of the departure of the CEO. But probably my default position is typically you want to move somebody out of the organisation. If they want to go, it's not necessarily productive to seek to keep them there. If it's a more mutual thing, or there's some very personal circumstances, perhaps they're still invested and it makes sense. But typically, I think a clean break is better. Take the pain initially and then move on and put in place appropriate arrangements to allow the company to keep moving forward.
There's a really good Chinese proverb that says loose ends turn into snakes. So if you're talking about a probation period, for example, and that may be 3 months, then I think certainly from our side, where we're looking at it, when these issues can sometimes cause a greater dispute between the executive and the company, kill it quick is typically the best way to go.
Sometimes the best way to see how the market is reacting to a CEO leaving early is through the share price. And it's a bit of a mixed bag as to what we see here. For example, some shares fall, others rise. Let's talk a little bit about the financial ramifications of a CEO departing. What are some of those implications?
Well, in terms of the movements in share price, this is really about the perception of the market. How has the company been performing to that point? And how does the market perceive the CEO's or executive's role in that has been? If they've been seen as very important to a company that's been performing very well, it's quite likely to suffer some significant adverse share price movements. If the company's not been performing so well and the CEO is perceived as being a big part of the problem, then the share price might bounce and move up because of the departure, because the perception is that it's now better for the company and it can move forward. So that's the sort of the macro share price types environment. And then of course there's more specific cost to the company of, you know, notice periods, replacement costs, and unseen opportunity costs, I suppose, as well, in terms of senior people leaving. What impact does it have on the business? What do you need to do to ensure you're shoring up support with customers, suppliers, staff, making sure that there's no underlying concerns there that might have an adverse impact on the performance of the company?
I think also from the company's perspective, Elisha, too, there's some, you know, key messaging that needs to be provided around the time. So, for example, if there's a probation period and it's just not working out, there's a poor cultural fit or a divergence between the direction that the executive wants to take the company as opposed to where the board sees it going, then there might be some messaging about that that perhaps preserves the company's position, as opposed to the market making a judgment about, you know, poor judgment at the time of hiring the executive, or alternatively, something not quite right with the company, or the executives come in and seen something, found the skeletons and decided I'm out of here early. So it needs to be, I think, usually some important messaging around why it's happened, when it's happened, if it's appropriate to do so.
So wrapping up today, gentlemen, I feel you're both best placed to answer my final point. What are the legal avenues for both companies that want to limit the damage and also the ex-employers who want to protect their brand?
Well, I'll let perhaps Ash talk to some of the contractual, more litigious things, but I think very importantly, there's a lot of operational type things. Companies really need to sometimes go into a crisis management mode if there's unexpected departures of senior executives. So it's shoring up, yeah, the market's expectations, customers, suppliers, any key stakeholders, and ensuring that the right messaging is sent about the future of the company and that it's still in good shape, etc. So that's really key from that level, but I'm sure Ash can talk to some of the more contractual matters.
Well, I think, again, it depends on, you know, what has caused the parting of ways, so to speak. But, I mean, we would generally counsel that certainly from the company's perspective, they need to have a clear understanding of the contractual obligations on both sides, so theirs and the executives. I mean, typically these executive service agreements that are signed these days would specify with a fair degree of clarity about the obligations on both sides in terms of maintaining confidentiality, you know, not disparagement, no conflict if they're serving out a notice period, and also, I guess, the next step, looking at whether or not there is a need to have that negotiation around the notice period and whether we're going to cut it short or perhaps extend. And the same applies, in my view, on the employee side. So again, they want to have a clear understanding of their rights and obligations under their contract. And then depending on the circumstances, there may follow a discussion about how there can be a, you know, parting of the ways with maximising mutual benefit, so to speak. So the parties can move on with as little fuss as possible.
Good to get both of your insights amid this time. Ashley Hill and Scott Standen from GRT Lawyers, thanks for joining us today.
Thanks, Alicia.